For those of you who don't know, I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience, but I'm Sarah Ladislaw. I'm a senior fellow here at CSIS's Energy and National Security Program. And it is my great pleasure to host today's event along with our good colleagues over at E3G on Bridging the Climate Divide: Can Risk Management Reveal a Prudent Path Forward? We're really pleased to have the opportunity to be hosting this discussion today. For those of you who come to our events relatively often, you know that CSIS's Energy Program has spent a good deal of time dedicated to the question of climate change in terms of the impact on the energy sector and the impact that the energy sector has on climate change. We've done some work on the security impacts of climate change and on some of the science and adaptation questions, but the bulk of our work has really been looking at the different sort of factors leading to a low-carbon development pathway. Today, we're going to sort of shift focus, and it's sort of in line with what has happened at a number of our recent events. Not too long ago, we had the World Energy Outlook presented here by the International Energy Agency, where we really explored and questioned some of their critical pathway assumptions about whether or not the world was in fact going to reach a 2-degree target in terms of limiting the temperature rise associated impacts that would happen from climate change. In addition, not too long ago, we had Dr. Jonathan Pershing, Deputy Climate Envoy from the United States, talk about the impact and what happened in Cancun in terms of the climate negotiations, and asked sort of similar critical questions about whether or not we were on track to meet that goal. And our focus in those discussions was really on, you know, what happens to the energy sector, because that's sort of what we focus on the most. But there's also a flip side of that question, and it's about what the overarching strategic framework is for us dealing with climate change. And so when E3G came to us and said that they have this report coming out, and we know that there's a lot of other really interesting groups around town who are working on these types of issues, but we thought that it would be our place, in the interest of having a balanced discussion, to bring this issue to light and to invite some people to talk about just that issue. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to invite some of the authors, two of the authors of this report, to present the risk and the management aspects, as Nick had just said, of this issue, and then invite some very informative colleagues to open up a discussion, and then open up a discussion with all of you. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our first two speakers. Dr. Jay Gulledge, Senior Scientist and Director for Science and Impacts from the Pew Center on Global Climate Change, and Nick Mabey, the CEO and Founding Director of E3G, to sort of set the scene about what we're going to be talking about today. So thanks very much, Jay.
Nope, not mine.
You're the middle one.
There we go. One that says Gulledge. Get it now. Sarah, thanks a lot, and thanks for organizing this. It's a fabulous event, and CSIS is such a terrific host and has such a great draw, so very pleased to be here. as Nick just said, the science is what describes the risk, so I'm the risk and he's the management, and so I'm going to try to explain very, very quickly some very just core principles about uncertainty and risk as a way of providing a basis for which to talk about managing those risks. The first thing to just get off the table here is the question of whether or not climate change is actually a national security issue. Now, I'm not a national security expert, so I'm not going to try to authoritatively make that case, but I'll just leave it up to some very serious hard security experts who have now confirmed again and again and again from within DOD, the National Intelligence Community, CNA, the UK Ministry of Defense. They have all written this into their doctrines, their strategic analyses, and they all conclude that it is a security risk. Climate change entails security risk. And some of the things that they point to as elevating risk, as the way climate change elevates risk, is things like the opening of the Arctic and the fact that we don't know how to govern that space yet internationally. Potential for, we know that natural resources competition can spark intrastate conflicts, and climate change could amplify those types of problems. We know that we provide a lot of aid and disaster response for extreme weather disasters. And one of the things that that the climate science is quite clear on is that we should expect more of those. So these are the types of things that interact with the security space according to the defense and security community. So these are risks that need to be managed, and there is not much of a risk management discussion involved in the national and international policy debates about how to deal with climate change, which are being handled primarily through a traditional environmental policy frame, which doesn't really have that long culture of risk management like the national security community does. And so we think that it makes sense to borrow from the expertise and the way that the national the security community analyzes risk in dealing with climate change. And in fact, it took about 20 years, but the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, finally came to this conclusion on their own, and they do not come from a national security perspective traditionally. But in their last report, they said that responding to climate change involves an iterative risk management process that includes both adaptation and mitigation. Now, the definition of risk from an analytical standpoint is the probability that something will happen multiplied by the severity of its consequences. So the intensity of a rain or flood event multiplied by the probability that it might happen, for example. And so in risk management, there's two things you want to do. You want to try to reduce the probability that something bad will happen. And if it does happen, you want to reduce the impact that it'll have. So these are the kind of two basic elements of reducing risk. So how does risk relate to uncertainty? Because with climate change, one of the big reasons, and the reason the security community deals with risk management, is because most of the decisions they make are uncertain, or the things they're making decisions about are uncertain. That's the key thing about climate change. Not uncertain that it's happening or that it's going to have consequences, but the specifics of those consequences are very uncertain, especially in the future. We don't have a crystal ball. And uncertainty tempts people, i.e. decision makers, to disregard risk. And that's not a smart way to manage risk. And again, risk is probability times severity. So if you look at this probability distribution, any point along that distribution, you can multiply the probability on the left axis by the severity of the outcome on the horizontal axis and come up with a risk calculation. And one of the things that I want to point out is that as uncertainty increases, risk can actually increase. So, for example, here's another probability distribution. There is greater uncertainty built into this distribution. It's a wider uncertainty range. But if you look at the best estimates on both of these distributions, the risk is equal because you've got a lower probability but a higher severity, and so the risk is equal for the best estimate. But if you look out at the worst that can happen, the 95 percentile on both of these distributions, you now have more risk at the upper end for this more uncertain curve than you can have in the other one, right? So greater uncertainty can equate to greater risk, just from a purely analytical perspective. So the point, if you don't get anything else out of what I say today, I want you to get this. Scientific uncertainty, I'm not talking about the way my mom thinks what uncertainty means, right? Like, who knows, right? I'm talking about scientific uncertainty is quantified. It is information, and it is information that informs risk decisions, okay? That's what uncertainty is when you're dealing with analytical considerations of climate change. So let's get a little very briefly into the uncertainty that we have, information that we have about climate change. The key physical climate uncertainty is the climate sensitivity. That is, how much the climate would warm or the Earth's surface would warm if you doubled the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. Okay, that's how climatologists define climate sensitivity. Each of these curves is an independent estimate of that quantity. Okay, it's a probability distribution. They're kind of squiggly and a little bit different, but they all have a similar shape to them, right? They all have best estimates kind of in this range. They all have a long tail on them saying, there's some chance it could be very, very high, not much chance that it could be very, very low. So they all have this in common. If you put them all together, the IPCC came up with a best estimate for climate sensitivity of about 3 degrees. That's about a 40%, give or take, probability. Okay? That means 60% of your probability space is somewhere else. Okay? So there's even a 10% chance, 1 in 10 chance, that it might be 5 degrees or higher. Okay? And there's some small but non-negligible chance that it's out here at 10 degrees or higher. 2-3%, I don't know, something like that. Okay? I don't get on an airplane that has a 2-3% chance of falling out of the sky. And we actually have those calculations very well. We know the risk of getting on an airplane, and it's very low. So let's just look very quickly, conceptualizing what that uncertainty distribution means from a risk perspective. Okay? This is, if we just look at how much impacts we would incur from a doubling of CO2, there's uncertainty about that. Our best estimate is that we'd be, if we just kind of look at this cartoon as the range of assessed range of risks for warming, okay? Our best estimate is we'd be right in the middle of that range, okay? But there's a 10% chance that we're going to be out near the top end of that range, okay? And then there's a non-negligible chance that we're off the chart, that we don't have the ability to assess what the climate looks like or what the world looks like in a climate that's warmer than 6 degrees, that warms by more than 6 degrees. This, from a risk management perspective, has a lot of information in it. One piece of information is that it says, we want to take this off the table. We do not want to go there, okay? We want to take that off the table. That's that long tail on the probability distribution. That's one piece of information that it gives us. This is my last slide. This is a probability distribution for how much the Earth would warm for a given amount of greenhouse gas emissions. And I don't remember off the top of my head which greenhouse gas emission scenario this is. Not really relevant for the points I want to make. But this is a business as usual projection for warming. It's uncertain. Something like a 30% chance is our best estimate that it would be between 3 and 4 degrees. Okay. This may even be a doubling scenario. I'm not sure. But now, with a mitigation scenario where we reduced emissions by 1% per year, starting now, let's say, we would get a probability distribution that looks something like this. Okay, so we clearly, whatever the right answer is in this curve, we know that we will reduce the warming. That will take some impacts off the table. But there's some key features I want to point out. Yes, we reduce the expected warming, and we increase our confidence a little bit that it'll be something below 3 degrees. Okay, we reduce our best estimate of warming by about 0.8 degrees Celsius. But there's something more important about this. If we look at, this is the 5% line, okay? So this is the 95 percentile in this distribution. We've moved it down, okay? That's the sort of the tail on that curve that I showed you. And what I want to point out is that while we moved the best estimate down by less than a degree, we've moved the 95 percentile tail down by well more than a degree. The point is, mitigating greenhouse gas emissions gives you extra leverage at the high risk end of the curve. It's added value in terms of taking the worst off the table. It gives you extra leverage at that level. Moreover, okay, this is a warming estimation for a given amount of greenhouse gas emissions. The climate sensitivity, if we've underestimated the climate sensitivity, that's a risk, right? And so we have, the point is, these curves are for the best estimate of climate sensitivity. Okay, but if we've underestimated that, there's going to be more warming. What this table shows is how much this thing shifts to the left if we've underestimated the climate sensitivity. If the climate sensitivity is higher, let's say 6 degrees, what I want to show you is that you shift it to the left even more. So even though it's uncertain, what we are certain about is that we get extra leverage from mitigation of greenhouse gas emissions as the more we've underestimated it. So the value of the emissions reductions is very much amplified by the fact, from a risk management perspective, by the fact that you've reduced your worst risks. And the more you're on the bad side of the underestimating, the more benefit you're getting from the mitigation. That's it.
Great. Thanks, Jay. Nick?
Okay, so you can see from Jay's presentation that explaining probability distributions to senior decision makers is not the easiest thing in the world, even though Jay is probably the best person I know at doing it. And therefore, one of the points of risk management is how do we turn some of the information, a very simplified version of which you've just seen, into decisions? And that's really what this report is about, and how decisions, many levels. And as always, where did we get to? Why did we do this report in the first place? Well, we've been doing climate security work in E3G since 2005, and before that in our jobs in government, many of us. And as we took this report forward, we did a lot of work with bringing climate security analysts together to talk about the areas that Jay is discussing. And then with Jay and Bernard Fennell, who helped us, we could draft this report and put it forward. And we've tested these ideas along with lots of people in the security community, also in the climate community. And so what we're trying to do is open a debate, because one thing we found during the process of the report is where we think it's given us quite a robust way of thinking the overall framework of the problem. The more we dug into some of the areas we didn't know about, the more we saw incredible need for further work and further research. Because as with many times when you put a new lens on a problem, it really opens up and shows huge area of ignorance, which you haven't really pushed into before. So we're not claiming it's the last word, we're hoping it's one of the first words on this debate. And why did we do it? So firstly, our work on climate security showed really, especially from a security point of view, from a senior decision maker's point of view, we were really interested in the kind of extreme impacts which Jay's talked about. That was the bit that worried us most, was kind of going into these places where you got really serious impacts on security and stability at home and overseas. But most of the analysis we were seeing done by people was looking at kind of the middle of the curve, really, and it didn't actually include a lot of the latest science on extreme impacts and stability. But we also didn't see a lot of discussion of these worst cases in the debate on climate change, because this uncertainty, equating uncertainty with action, seemed to make people afraid of talking about the full range of uncertainty. They wanted to kind of talk about this, you know, we can meet 2 degrees, instead of saying, well, if we do this, we've got a 50% chance of meeting 2 degrees. And the contrast between the two communities, which we span, between the security community and the climate community, really came home. Because obviously, in security, lots of extremely expensive decisions are made under much more uncertainty than climate data. And one which is really out there at the moment, which is a huge difference across the Atlantic, is actually, what is the threat that China will pose in 2050? So you're trying to predict the political leadership of China, as well as its economics and demographics and, you know, internal politics in 2050, because that's really important to know what weapon systems you need to build and how you construct alliances. And that's a real question of now. That is a lot more uncertain than some of the climate data. So we could pose ourselves a question, which said, okay, how would our climate strategy look if we treated it as seriously as nuclear proliferation and applied the same type of framework of thinking as we do on nuclear proliferation? And so we took risk management, and you know, to go through what risk management is and perhaps isn't, it's broader than some of the economic techniques people use, optimization, cost benefit, real options, though it can include all of those techniques. It's a very pragmatic approach. It's about making policy decisions under uncertainty. It's not about a theoretical answer, it's about making decisions. It's got a long history of success and a certainly large one of failure in the security field and, as we found out recently, in the finance field and resource management and infrastructure management, but there's been a lot of learning. We know a lot about how people make good and bad decisions under uncertainty. And it's really important that risk management is about who. It's often about who's making the decision as much as what and how much. It's not as abstract as things like economics and science, to be honest, because it takes into account the human part of the equation, which is incredibly important. And if you've got humans, you've got politics, so it's a way of framing political debates. It's not replacing them, and we'll come to that at the end. And it's something we do all the time. We have big debates about big existential issues like deterrence versus disarmament on nuclear, civil liberties versus terrorism, intervention in conflict versus isolationism. The public has those debates, policymakers have those debates, they have huge uncertainty around them, but we make decisions while holding a debate, and then we do it again and again and again. And at the heart of all those debates is a simple question: how much risk should we take And that is what a risk management system is trying to get you to defining that in the best way possible. And to do the report, we went through a methodology which is quite similar to most security people understand this one. We did a bit of intelligence gathering. We looked at the science. We looked at what we knew and didn't know across science, climate science, impacts, and mitigation. So it looks at how certain are we we're going to achieve all these reductions if we wanted to do them, and adaptation. Then we did assessment. We tried to look at what we knew and didn't know, what our biases were, what this meant for strategic decisions, so classic assessment phase. And then we analyzed what our responses were. How effective were our responses in these areas? Did we have responses? Were they being implemented properly? Were they sufficient to mitigate the risks within the right place? And the short answer is, we're not managing any of the risks particularly well, and we don't have a clear framework for dealing with it. And there's a lot in the report which goes through that in quite a lot of detail. So pulling from that analysis, we went into, okay, how would we explain a risk management framework at the highest level and kind of taking away all the complexity of the science and trying to put it together? And one way, and this is just one example, is to use scenarios. We use scenarios a lot. And the two axes we use for scenarios here are climate sensitivity on the y-axis, high to low, which is, as Jay talked about, and on the x-axis, successful mitigation policies and failed mitigation policies. So simple. Control, sensitivity. And really, I'm not going to go through the details of this, but if we, this is saying, okay, if we want to aim to keep global temperatures below 2 degrees, which is the global target, which has been agreed by all countries in the UN, well, the best outcome is we do the mitigation we say we want to do, and it's reasonably low climate sensitivity estimate in the median range, and we may get a 2 to 3 degree outcome, a nice green outcome in the bottom. But even if we're successful on mitigation, could be we're higher up the curve. And that means we might have 3 to 5 degrees of warming, and then we'd have to do some kind of crash response and return. But it's also possible that we fail to meet our mitigation targets, then we move over to the left-hand side, and we could get anywhere up to 6 to 8 degrees, especially if we move beyond tipping points. So even if we make the decision to move to 2 degrees, we have, because of the uncertainty of delivery and the uncertainty in the climate system, a wide range of possible scenarios to move forward. And we haven't even realistically aimed to deliver this with a set of policies behind it. So a risk management system has to respond to all those probable scenarios in a way forward. So the way we've done that is by saying you need a simple framework at one level, which is called the ABC risk management framework, just to stick in people's heads. So firstly, aim to mitigate to stay below 2 degrees. And the numbers here are less important than the framework, but this is just taking the kind of consent median view at the moment. But even if we're doing that, we need to build and budget for our infrastructure, for our security forces, for our disaster response, to resilience to 3 to 4 degrees. Because many, we have to make decisions now for many of these things. We can't just assume we're going to hit this 2 degrees. It's a very poor risk management. I sit on the UK government's infrastructure committee, and we're currently looking at what our planning assumptions are for infrastructure out for the next 20 to 30 years. And we can't take the government's objective of 2 degrees as our planning assumption. But also, we need to, and that's real money spending now. But we also need a contingency plan to respond to the really bad worst case scenarios. It might be 2, 3, 5, 10%, but that's a big risk for a huge impact. What would we do in that situation? And the point is, these elements are the same for every country. An Indian farmer would look at this very differently to the Indian steel industry. Like Russia will look at this very differently to the Maldives. There's no universal risk management approach because it is about who you are, what you would populate the numbers with, but that framework remains the same, and the differences between the numbers in the framework are very much the essence of climate politics done in the right way. They're about real choices, about real resilience, and how much you invest in resilience, contingencies, and in mitigation. And so taking that framework and looking across what we're doing, and I'm not going to go through these in detail, we set out 10 in the report, 10 proposals for kind of first steps towards a risk management approach, which we think are pretty critical. Firstly, on the idea of the area of aiming to stay below 2 degrees, you know, let's look at the mitigation goals, and I'll go in some detail in that later. Investment in transformational RD&D, get clean technologies out there faster, make the global regime work, and independent national risk assessments. Those are all elements, and again, I'll go into some of them later, which we think are critical for actually delivering that type of goal. You can't just hope. At the moment, we have a let's hope we get there rather than an actual robust strategy for delivering it. On building and budgeting for 3 or 4 degrees, we think we need adaptation strategies that really look at perfect storms and interdependent impacts. We tend to look at things in silos. One of the big lessons we got out of the discussion was we need to look at how things interact, as they have in Tunisia and areas. We haven't looked at 2008, 2011 real lessons. We need increased cooperation to react to preventive humanitarian intervention. Look at how our resource management frameworks, fisheries agreements, water agreements, trade agreements, how resilient are they to these stresses they're going to see? Because that architecture of agreement is one of the most critical things preserving prosperity and security globally. And we need to have better tools and data to actually invest in these areas. We found a huge gap, and I think that the US Navy's also pointed this out, between the data scientists provide and the data decision makers need to actually make investment decisions. And lastly, on contingency planning, we need to look at the propensity for crash programs as we move, as we think about high impacts. So just a few, touching on a few of these to give you a flavor of some of the issues. So we think the sustainable global response fundamentally lies on the basis of national climate risk assessments. However, most countries do not have clear goals. I mean, looking back to Jay's recommendation, is the goal of the US or the EU, if they say 2 degrees, what does that mean? What percentage for 2 degrees? Would it be more meaningful to say we don't want to get 4 degrees, because that's where some really bad impacts are happening? Or if you're India, is it about the likelihood of the monsoon shifting? Actually, you look around, you don't see a lot of evidence that countries have really gone for a core process of understanding their core interests and what that turns into in terms of a focus outcome. And one of the reasons is the actors who are really affected, who run the national infrastructure, who run national security, who deal with food security, are not in the debate about what the country's overall goals are. So we don't have around the table setting strategies for delivering mitigation or global strategies on this, all the actors who are affected for real, not just on paper, but the real actors. So our point is, just like so many other areas we're looking at the moment, that whole of government risk assessment is critical for defining national interests. And it's critical that that is not done by the policy lead department. At the moment, you have climate change responsible departments saying how likely it is to achieve an outcome. We all know that you should never have policy assessment mixed. It's a basic tenet of security policy. We need the assessment done by an independent branch of government so that we can review and update our risk management process as we go along. Secondly, on the adaptation, on the kind of budgeting for 3 to 4, again, we think we need to identify clear planning scenarios at national level. Again, the US is looking at investing on $1 trillion in infrastructure soon. What's the planning assumption going to be for that infrastructure investment? That could be the difference between building a liability and an asset. We know that we have to look at some beyond the technical issues in lots of these areas. Post-Pakistan, the flood reconstruction, if we don't understand how that affects social conditions, power values, that reconstruction, how resilient is it to climate change, we won't achieve our security objectives, the stability in parts of Pakistan. It's mixed up. So again, but we know we don't have the data and tools to address this and do it properly. So there's a huge potential for cooperative action, particularly across the Atlantic, to build those tools and decision support systems, because we all have very similar jobs and we're often doing this in the same place, places like Pakistan or the Sahel, Sub-Saharan Africa. So there's a huge potential there for cooperation to improve our risk management systems. To produce things like this is a map of vulnerability in West Africa, and highly detailed. And this is a piece of work done looking at the really close link between conflict and rainfall in Uganda. These are exceptions. We do not have much data of this resolution, but without it, it's very difficult to actually work on the ground. And finally, on this, crash programs. If we have a really big policy failure, which isn't that unlikely given where we are at the moment, or very high climate sensitivity, there'll be enormous political pressure or panic for a crash response. Let's do something. Geoengineering, massive rollout of nuclear power stations. They can have huge side effects on the security side, like proliferation. And some of them are just non-feasible. But we know panic does not make good decision making. So we need, and it's prudent, to develop contingency planning and regulation of things like geoengineering and some of the core technological options so they're available, but they're going to be managed in a good way, because we have no certainty at all that we're going to avoid these scenarios. And one thing is we're not even monitoring many of the most extreme areas, like the dieback of the Amazon or methane emitted from some of the multipliers of climate change, very well. So one of our biggest things we found was this kind of lack, reluctance to plan for the worst case scenarios, despite everybody agreeing how terrible they would be. But we need some international agreement and cooperation very soon to deal with that. And we get to the egg. So that's great. That's a lot of high policy. And it's kind of great for people to do security planning. And there's lots of recommendations from national planners and militaries and infrastructure people who love probability distributions. But what about the public? The public are the egg. This is the egg. They can understand this because, in the end, this comes down to a very simple idea. How tense does it make you feel watching an egg sitting on the end of a table? This is the situation we're in. Stable. Doesn't look like it's moving. Perhaps it's moving imperceptibly. But if it goes too far, we know it will fall, and we know it's fragile. That contains a lot of emotional assumptions about the world as a system, which often people don't have. They think the world is very robust, a rubber ball, not an egg, but it isn't. All the evidence shows it's fragile, the system is very dislocated. We are near the edge, we're not in the middle of the table. We're very near tipping points in the global climate system. And I think this is one of the things we've lacked, is an ability to communicate and start a conversation which can communicate some of the rich science, the information around the uncertainty, which Jay's talked about, into the public debate. And so our final point, as well as all the technical and policy and other issues, is, and this came to us really through the process of this report, but in many ways for me is one of the most powerful takeaways, is that risk management really gives us an opportunity to reframe the public debate in an incredibly positive way. Because the current debate, and this is particularly US, but it's also in many other countries across Europe, China, India, so I don't think this is split into climate skeptics and believers, is really unhelpful, and it really leads to an underemphasis of both the climate uncertainties and these extreme scenarios. It also alienates the majority of people who, from all the polling in every country, essentially believe climate change is an issue, but are very confused about what to do with it, but do not want to be identified with either camp, which they seem as extremes. And that alienation of the centrist middle really undermines effective policymaking, because you don't make decisions with an unstable center. All politicians know that. And so what we like about risk management is it allows a debate where all the information can be used and assessed, and it's pragmatic and not belief-based approach, but you can have different views. People can have different views legitimately without being stigmatized as being one thing or another. And you can have it, it's not just they have views, they can have a conversation. They can have a conversation, people can have a conversation about how much climate risk are you prepared to take in the coffee shop or the pub or in the house, just like we had conversations about deterrence in the Cold War, just like we have conversations about civil liberties versus terrorist risk. We do this on many other issues of similar import in a place, but we have to have a conversation, not a broadcasting of people. And we have to allow them to look at risk and understand risk themselves. So that's what we feel, and this is, you know, as I said, the beginning, not the end, what we'd like to do taking forward the report is to explore how we can change these conversations, promote the conversations, do the policy work, but also think how this might change the way we talk and think about climate change to allow us to actually make some decisions. Because the one thing we also know, if we're not making decisions, the risk is only going up. Because inaction means more greenhouse gas in the atmosphere and higher risks. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Nick and Jay, for a wonderful presentation of the risks and a great view of a way to start the discussion about a new strategic framework going forward, whether it's the risk management framework you put forward or another one. I've actually been at conferences that lasted 3 or 4 days and covered the material that you all just covered in about 20 minutes, so you should be congratulated. You take our friends at E3G at their word about this being the beginning of a conversation. What we'd like to do is help them foster that discussion and wanted to do so today by turning it over to a good friend, Ed McBride, from The Economist, who has covered issues like this for a while and can help us facilitate a discussion by asking us all the really difficult questions. But starting off with the next part of the learning curve, which is what is security officials, some examples of what security officials here in the United States are doing about some of these issues and how they feel about some of the things that Jay and Nick just talked about. So, Ed.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sarah. Hello, everyone. I just want to quickly sort of basically do myself down. I'm afraid I'm not the environment correspondent of The Economist, which it says in your handouts. I used to be, so I'm horribly out of date. And please forgive me if I, say anything that sounds like it's about a year old. thankfully, I'm not doing most of the talking. We've got two respondents now who are both going to make a brief initial remarks and then join a panel discussion here. And then we're going to also take questions and have a discussion with the audience. I will just introduce our two respondents. The first to speak is Courtney St. John. She has the words climate change twice in her title, so that gives you a hint. She's the climate change affairs officer at the United States Navy's Task Force on Climate Change. She, like our second respondent, is part of the American Armed Forces planning and long-term strategic thinking in response to climate change. And so she is very familiar with the kind of approach that we've heard Nick and Jay talk about. And I'll hand it over to you to make your initial
remarks.
Thank you.
And we have to extend a special thanks to Courtney, because she has gotten the duty that we've all experienced here in Washington of being a last-minute fill-in for somebody who wasn't able to make it, Rear Admiral Titley. So we're very pleased that you're able to be here in his place.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And I'm just going to talk briefly here about the Navy's approach to dealing with climate change and managing the national security risks associated with them, and sort of our approach to how we've dealt with it over the past couple of years since the establishment of Task Force Climate Change. And as you can see here, TFCC, as we like to call it, was established in May 2009 by the Chief of Naval Operations with a charter that really focuses on the global implications of climate change with a near-term focus on the Arctic. So the Navy recognizes that, contrary to what many of us learned in middle school, the geography of the planet is changing. And we understand that these changes will help us, gaining a good understanding of them will help us to ensure readiness for the Navy in the 21st century, which is really our primary goal. So specifically, I'll talk a little bit about what we're doing. We have two roadmaps, one focused solely on the Arctic and one on global climate change writ large, that identify specific action items to guide decision making and investments. And our prediction for the Arctic specifically is that there will be roughly 4 weeks of ice-free conditions in the 2035 to 2040 timeframe. But the risk for conflict even in that timeframe remains relatively low. Thus, we have to complete the studies and assessments now that will ensure that we're not buying ahead of need and that we understand the risks that we face in that changing environment. We also work very closely with our sister task force, Task Force Energy, which is also listed up here. And their goal is to increase energy security and tactical flexibility of the Navy. And we really recognize that these are two sides of the same coin. They're inextricably linked between adapting to changing conditions and making the changes that are necessary in the way that the Navy does business. So as part of our efforts, we've developed an adaptation framework, which I'm sure doesn't look dissimilar to many other adaptation frameworks that are out there. And it forms the basis for all of our decision making, specifically starting with the climate change observation and predictions. We recognize that geography is changing because the observations, not even the models or predictions, are telling us that. We work closely with scientists in the federal government and academia and other research institutes to ensure that we have the best access to these observations that we can then utilize to quantify uncertainty and recognize that, you know, the distribution of the impacts may not be uniform. So specifically for impact and risk assessment, we're engaging with subject matter experts, the good work being done in a lot of the national labs and within federal agencies and other institutions. I think the distribution that you see on the right there, Water Resources, was taken from Sandia National Labs and their very thorough assessment of water resource risks in the U.S. We're partnering with NOAA and the Air Force, among other federal agencies, in an effort to recapitalize the nation's modeling capabilities that will develop a coupled system that predicts changes on a regional scale with the time frames that the Navy operates, sort of the 0 to 30 years out. And as I've discussed, our near-term focus is the Arctic because, as the QDR states, which I'm sure Dr. Chu will touch on, and other defense guidance, that is the environment in which we're seeing the most rapid changes with implications for maritime forces. So we've released the Navy's Arctic strategic objectives, which were signed by the Vice Chief of Naval Operations in May 2010. And we're also currently conducting assessments of gaps in capabilities over specific time frames to determine the risk to adaptation and mission in that region. We're also analyzing and monitoring longer-term impacts of climate change for the Navy, such as the effects of sea level rise on our installations worldwide and the implications for our basing around the world, and changing resource distribution and the related effects of ocean acidification. So all of these activities together will ensure that we're ready and capable in the 21st century. Thank you.
Thanks, Courtney. We'll move straight on to our second respondent, who's Dr. Daniel Chu. Like Courtney, but with a slightly broader lens, he's looking at some of the risks facing the United States and its armed forces in the future as Principal Director of Strategy in the Office of the Secretary of Defense. So climate change is just one of those risks, and so he'll now give us a slightly
broader view of the threats facing the US military.
Okay, thanks. It might be easier if I just jump off the edge of the stage. I don't actually have any slides, but everybody else is speaking up here, so I'm going to speak up here. But I still want credit for being from the Department of Defense and not having slides. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks very much. Thanks in particular to CSIS for inviting me here to speak on climate change and risk. Climate change is obviously a very important issue to the Department of Defense, as I'll discuss with you here this afternoon. And risk management for national security is our job. So obviously, climate change and risk is of particular interest to us. Let me also give thanks and credit to the authors of this particular report for, I think, highlighting some very, very important climate change issues and laying out some great risk management principles that I think are not only applicable here, but quite frankly are applicable across a range of issues, including the ones we deal with in DoD. So as you've heard, I'm the principal director of an office called Strategy. Let me tell you a little bit what that is, because otherwise it sounds pretty vague. We are inside the Office of the Secretary of Defense, in particular inside the Office of the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, and we do a lot of long-term planning and analysis for the overall Department of Defense, so we really do have a much broader, longer-term view. We also do nearer-term, near and mid-term issues. I call them kind of strategy development and policy development pieces. Often we're thought of as kind of the Secretary's think tank, so we develop a lot of different products and issues for his and for our leadership's consideration. And climate change is one of the keys, along with energy and some other issues, including the Arctic, as Courtney mentioned. One of the products you're probably, many of you at least, are probably most familiar with that our office is pivotal in producing is the Quadrennial Defense Review. And you saw Jay refer to it in one of his slides, and others have as well. Quadrennial Defense Review, as its name suggests, is something we put out every 4 years, but more importantly is intended to provide our broad outlook on the future security environment, near, mid, and long-term issues for the Department of Defense, and a strategy for approaching those issues and challenges as we go forward. So let me start with that and talk a little bit about how we see climate change in the Quadrennial Defense Review. We view it very much as integral as we look at strategy going forward. The strategy that you see in the Quadrennial Defense Review, we like to call the four P's, and if any of you have read it, you probably know them. The first, of course, is to prevail in today's conflicts. The second is prevention and deterrence of future conflicts. The third is preparing for a wide range of challenges and contingencies in a future security environment. And finally, we need to do all of this while we preserve and enhance the all-volunteer force. There's a couple of things in saying those four P's out loud that I just want to highlight to you that I think are important as you consider the QDR. First is you can hear from prevailing in today's conflicts to preparing to prevail, essentially, in any future conflicts or contingencies. You're hearing both a near and a long-term perspective in there. We think that's critical for a couple of reasons. First of all, this is the first QDR that specifically acknowledges and looks at current operations as part of our risk management framework. Secondly, as I say that, it also implies that as we think about risk management, we are not just thinking about managing risk across ranges of challenges, but across time as well, which we think is absolutely critical in thinking about these issues, and I would suggest is critical in thinking about climate change issues as well. Another key item to note in this particular QDR is if you look at the section where we talk about the mid and longer term challenges in the future security environment piece, some of the features that we note quite explicitly here are the complexity, the uncertainty, and the change inherent in future security environment. As such, you cannot take anything but a risk management approach to these types of challenges. We frankly reject the notion that there is that we have the predictive power to plan for specifics and frankly take a strategic planning approach that aims to create flexible, adaptable, and robust planning across ranges of challenges. Again, very much consistent with a risk management approach. So I think you'll see a lot of commonalities there between how we look at future security problems in general and the climate change issue in particular. Finally, I've already said it many times, but just to add it to the list, we also include in the QDR an explicit intent to look at risk management not only as an approach to strategic planning and analysis, but also for the department as well. The Department of Defense, as you all well know, is very large and diverse and has to deal with everything from installations and healthcare for its personnel to dealing with future adversaries of state and non-state actors and climate change issues as well. As a result, we have quite a mix of apples and oranges and watermelons and washing machines and all these sorts of different things that we need to try and deal with in our risk management portfolio. It makes it a particularly challenging one to do, but we still believe, even with that diversity, that it's absolutely critical to do risk management in the department, and I'll talk to you briefly about how we do that as well. But finally, let me just say that one of the most important features probably for this audience is that this is the first QDR that is explicitly has explicitly and specifically identified climate change as an important issue for national security. And that should not go unnoticed. We believe that very strongly. That's why we're here today, and I'll talk to you a little bit about all the different ways we think about that. In general, if you look at the QDR, you'll see we talk about climate change as something of a threat multiplier or an accelerant to instability, because we recognize that while climate change alone doesn't cause conflict per se, it can certainly contribute to the conditions that make conflict either more likely, more problematic, broader, wider, these sorts of things. So at least for our terminology, we consider that a threat multiplier of sorts. As a result, we really think that climate change has to be taken into consideration when we think about everything from our installations, both in the United States and overseas, as well as DOD's roles, missions, and the operating environment in which we will be undertaking those roles and missions, again, both in the kind of near term and out into the longer term as well. In the QDR, you will see that when we talk about risk management, and remember again, when DOD talks about risk management, we're talking about what we're calling enterprise-wide risk management, and the enterprise for DOD is the Department of Defense. We're not talking about from a whole of government USG perspective, although we obviously play a critical or a key role there. When we think about risk management in the department, we think about it in particular, in four key categories. One is operational risk. That is the ability of our forces to conduct operations, both the current operations that you see now, but any other types of near-term operations, and execute our strategy successfully with the right capabilities, the right capacity, the right training, et cetera. The second is force management risk. We can't do that first, those operational duties, if we don't have the ability to recruit, retain, train, and maintain the all-volunteer force that provides the manpower for those and the capabilities for those operations. The next is institutional risk. The Department of Defense is a department. It has many processes, it has many systems that support it, some better than others, and our intent is to consider those explicitly as we think about how they support both operations, force management, and the last category, future challenges risk. Because we need to think not just about what we're doing today and what we intend to be doing in the next couple of years, but we need to look out more broadly at the future. So that's how we look at risk in general in the department, and I want to just quickly talk to you about how we think about climate change, frankly, in all of those categories, because it is appropriate in each of them. I'm going to start by talking about future challenges risk, but I will make a quick disclaimer here. I am not a climate scientist. I'm a strategic planner. So as a result, what you're going to hear me talk about are the types of scenarios, the types of things that we are planning for, but they're not intended to be either predictive, prescriptive, or proscriptive in any way. But as the Department of Defense, our job, again, is to look out into the future and identify the range of things we need to be prepared for. So from a climate change perspective, we've looked at projections and we've extrapolated from that some specifics that we need to be prepared for. Those include, for example, changes in weather patterns that might result in more severe weather, for example, and as a result, greater incidence of crises that might require humanitarian assistance or disaster relief. As a result, if those incidences rise, the need for DOD to respond, DOD is not always the respondent and is often in the supporting role, but the overall need for us to respond may be greater. The specifics may be different, the capabilities may be different, and we need to look at all of those, and we do. Issues like sea level rise leading to mass migrations and how DoD may have to respond to that, either because the mass migrations could cause instability or conflict, or because, again, they could cause some sort of humanitarian relief situation that DoD needs to be involved in as well, is something we look at as well. Climate change leading to issues of resource scarcity, water, for example, likewise could lead to instability, could lead to conflict, could lead to humanitarian situations, all of which we're looking at from a scenario-based planning perspective for future challenges risk. The Arctic is another one that Courtney's already mentioned, and we are looking at very specifically the idea that there could be increased activity in the Arctic raises a number of issues from everything from the potential for there to be conflict should nation states or others choose to exercise or let's just say, you know, seek some elbow room in the Arctic to search and rescue ISR type issues, ISR kind of the surveillance and reconnaissance type issues in the Arctic as well, all of which we need to at least consider if there's going to be greater activity in the Arctic. You can already see me overlapping now with some of the other other categories like operational risk. Obviously, operational risk can include some of the scenarios that I've just discussed with you, including some of the Arctic issues, which are already issues for us, including some of the humanitarian operations. I'd also highlight that likewise, we've got some issues with regard to installations that can affect our operational capabilities. That leads us into, as well, the force management risk category, where if our installations are unable to maintain training and readiness, for example, for our forces, that can actually create challenges for our maintaining those ready forces to do everything from responding to these types of operations that I've already talked to doing everything up to crisis response and combat operations as well. We also have a particular challenge with regard to force management in as much as we rely to a pretty significant extent on the reserves for conducting many humanitarian assistance and disaster relief type operations, particularly in the United States, and the stress that places on them with regard to their training, availability, and readiness. Finally, on the institutional level, and you heard a little bit of this already from Courtney in terms of how the Navy is thinking about it, DoD is likewise thinking about how we can manage overall institutional risks in terms of not only our budget processes, but also in terms of installations, energy use, operational energy use, and so forth. We do that in conjunction with basically sister offices in AT&L who look at these on a day-to-day basis and ensure that we are looking at climate change, how climate change can affect those as well. So I've probably already spoken too long. I just want to close with a couple of key points for you to remember. That's how DoD is looking at not only risk management, but also climate change across that kind of those multiple lenses of risk management for the DoD enterprise. But DoD is DoD. We're not the U.S. government. Clearly, we want to play an important role in this. We believe we can demonstrate leadership, and we hope that we have in many initiatives that we've taken, not only on environmental issues and energy issues, but in the way that we are planning and doing risk management with regard to climate change. But we're not the lead in this case. So we look forward to collaborating with the broader interagency on this. I think advice that you're hearing here in terms of putting this in a risk management framework for that kind of discussion is good advice. And I think it will be important, particularly, and we've all seen the newspapers and heard the television and radio on the budgetary pressures that we're all facing now. This is a different kind of risk, but I just wanted to mention it. It's absolutely critical that we think of it in those terms. Risk cannot be viewed in a resource-unconstrained manner. We need to consider this in a resource-informed manner so that we apply resources in the best possible way. So when we think about the kinds of things that Jay was talking about in terms of mitigation through probability and consequence, that we remember to do that and consider as well the kind of cost-benefit over time so that we are applying our investments in the best possible area, whether that's in terms of an issue area, whether that's in terms of near-term versus longer-term issues, or whether that's in terms of which agency within the whole of government solution set we're applying to. I think that's particularly important because, quite frankly and very explicitly, DoD thinks we have some important things to do, but we would not want to detract from the many important things that the other agencies in the U.S. government need to do as well. And we think that that's why we need to have exactly this type of discussion in a structured framework so we can look at those in more detail. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Dan. Now we get to the discussion part. We'll draw in our two original speakers as well. But I might like to start with you, Courtney and Dan. I just, inspired by what you saw about the probability curves, the neglect of the extreme outcomes that we heard from Jay and Nick, could I ask you to indulge in a bit of sort of Maoist self-criticism? I mean, do you feel that in your job looking at these things, you and your colleagues give enough attention to extreme outcomes, you know, low probability but, you know, high risk scenarios? Is that something you're actively thinking about?
From the Navy perspective, I think it is. I think we've identified sort of our near term and longer term impacts, but we also give a lot of consideration to what the tipping points may be in the climate system and how that requires the Navy to act maybe sooner than it would if scenarios continue as normal. So that's definitely something that we think about.
From my perspective, I might actually dispute the premise of the question in this way. I actually think the Department of Defense is not only good at, but probably too good at, looking at low probability, high consequence events. That's partially because that's our job. That's what we're supposed to do, so that's okay. But I think if I were to go back to Jay's presentation, the issue here is the uncertainty piece. That's where it gets more complicated. So when you have great uncertainty with regard to either the probability or the consequences, which based on the level of information I think is what we're talking about here, not just on one of those, that's where it gets really problematic. We have some things we're doing, I don't know how else to put it, some processes we're trying to implement that are trying to deal with those kinds of broader, more uncertain types of potential challenges in the future. And I think we've got to continue trying to do that. Because in the past, quite frankly, we have taken low probability, high consequence events, and we're quite good at planning for those. It's these ones that are more uncertain and have a range of possible outcomes that we need to get better at planning for.
Well, exactly. I mean, this isn't quite like preventing a terrorist attack or planning for a possible future conflict with China. But, you know, those are singular events, I mean, maybe of long duration or great consequence. But when you're dealing with a sort of a spectrum of horrors like climate change, is it as simple to apply the kind of approach that we've been discussing?
As simple.
I mean, because I know you guys have got the terrible.
I was going to say, first of all, the approach isn't simple, I think. It's pretty complicated, but so appropriately so. But you're raising a good point, which is, you know, so in the past we've tended to think about discrete events or discrete kinds of challenges to plan for, and we do need to think more broadly than that, and that is something we are trying to institute. I talked about how we do scenario-based planning in the department. In the past we looked at single scenarios, you know, conflict with adversary X, conflict with adversary Y. We really are broadening that set now to look at future security environments, strategic contexts, which include things like, you know, the impacts of climate change and different assumptions with regard to trends and in those areas. It is complicated, it is difficult. We're instituting a lot of those processes now, but I think they're headed in the right direction. And frankly, they are very consistent with the broad risk management principles you saw laid out here, which intend to bring all of those together rather than, again, focusing on one element of it and then just taking that and essentially making everything else kind of a lesser included contingency.
Okay, well, so if I could sort of throw that back to you two in a way, I mean, it strikes me that there was a slight tension, I mean, not necessarily a contradiction, but that as you were presenting the risk management approach for climate change, you seemed to suggest it was useful both for persuading people who were skeptical of the need to do anything very much about climate change to sort of think of it in a different way, and for those people who are trying to respond in some way to climate change to make their response more rational. Does it work for both, or is it better for one or the other, or it, you know, good for both purposes?
I think it does work for both, in a sense that came organically out of the discussions we had. We started off thinking about it very much as how do we get this kind of whole of government approach and looks across. It was very much an elite focused project, but as we went through it and discussed it, and actually it came out as being and started thinking about the parallels to other issues, the issue about how to frame the public debate became more and more, so it grew organically out of the discussions. It wasn't something we were aiming for or imposed on the project. And I think it's quite the comparison with terrorism is actually I'd dispute with you on this, because I actually think it's a very interesting one. When we're planning to look strategically at terrorism over time, we're looking at what's the incidence of terrorism likely to be and the precursors of terrorism and have a model of understanding radicalization. And therefore, we have quite well-funded but badly implemented programs which are meant to be looking at that, which I used to work on at one time, in our own countries, in the UK, in Europe, in the US, but also particularly abroad in North Africa, Middle East. But we have to take a view on that. And the interesting thing there, of course, is that if we get it wrong, or there are hard security consequences for getting it wrong and not managing that risk down and de-radicalizing and providing different outlets for frustrations and tensions, but there's no hard security ways of reducing that risk. That has to be done through things like governance and dialogue and spread of democracy, various other soft power things. So unless you have a whole of government approach where the people who have to pick up the hard security consequences can take a view on how effective the civilian side are at reducing the risks and say, look, we've looked at your, we don't think it's working, and we can't manage the risks of your failure. You can't actually produce this feedback loop, which means you devote the political, financial, and institutional focus on lowering the risk. And that's one of the things that comes down is, without that feedback from the people who pick up the problem in kind of reactive terms, back to the preventive side, you know, you can just have people saying, well, we're gonna meet 2 degrees, it's the target. The fact that none of our programs have any chance of doing it, and therefore, you know, it's not there. So that's, I think, back to the most useful thing about this is this whole of government approach, very parallel to other security issues, is we need to get the people who are affected by policy failure and the people running the policy together around the table having an honest conversation about what's going on. Because at the moment, it's all a bit about hope and not about honesty.
Let me push you on that a little bit. I mentioned I'm no longer environment correspondent. I'm now writing about American politics, and so I had the privilege yesterday of watching one of the committees in the House of Representatives grill the administrator of the EPA, and they were very unhappy with the idea that she might do anything about climate change. And this morning I was at the big conservative jamboree, CPAC, and I saw a series of people who want to become president in 2012 explaining how one of the reasons why they should become president was they didn't want to do a damn thing about climate change. It's a little bit unfair, but I mean, those people who are certain, you know, the problem isn't uncertainty. The problem there is certainty that climate change isn't a problem. Does this framework help to engage them in any way?
Just to hear the audience's viewpoint, I mean, my viewpoint is if people have an ideological position about something, then no framework of rational discussion affects them. We know that from running. But I think if you look at the majority of people, the polling, people aren't ideologically convinced either way on climate change. Most of them think it is a real issue and it's a real problem. But they find the debate that has been set up completely alienating, and they're unable to involve it. They don't want to be involved in it. I'm not surprised. It's not a nice, I mean, that was great. It's not a nice debate to be in this country and in several other countries. So if we could create a space where it was a more normal place to talk about things, where you didn't get vilified as being some kind of unpatriotic for taking a view, which we've seen in many other issues again, as a precursor to bad policy, then I think it would make a difference. It's not an overnight panacea, but if I can't see how the current process actually is in America's interest or the world's interest in dealing with the security of the country. So you've got to have a go in many ways.
It's very much a veneer as well. This political dynamic can change on a dime and will. I mean, I don't know how, but I'm just saying that it's very volatile and thin, and so. The notion that represents some kind of very dense obstacle, I don't buy. For one thing, right now on the conservative side of the political debate, we have a very shrill voice that is not actually representative of a large segment of our population, according to the polling. And so, for example, Newt Gingrich's proposal last month that we abolish the EPA was resoundingly rejected by Republicans in a public poll.
I'm missing his talk right now to be here.
So I just wanted to make the point that is what you describe as a real phenomenon, but the notion that it's an obstacle that will stand there and be in the way permanently, I don't think so. Whereas we have very solid analytical work and a serious community of risk managers within the government and within the business community who will just keep doing their thing and will actually provide a base for when the politics kind of get out of the way. If they do, hopefully soon, then I think we can make progress.
Okay, well, let me sort of ask a variant on that question in a slightly sort of less extreme version, which is it. Do you see this method leading sort of inexorably to your ABC or your 10 points, Nick, that you mentioned in your presentation? Or can you separate the methodology from the conclusions? I mean, could you apply the same methodology, have a different bunch of people using it, and come up with very different conclusions about the best way forward?
I think in some of the 10 points in some ways are more because we chose things which were kind of such glaring problems in the way we did risk management. We tried to focus on the things about how we did things as opposed to the specific kind of like level or rate. But sure, if you ask the Maldives to run this, you'll end up with aim at 1.5 and below and a totally different set of building and budgeting because they're looking at much higher risks. If you ran it in India, you'd focus much more on the risk of the monsoon failing because that's by far, and you would actually not have temperatures in there for me. I'd have very different pieces in there. One of the, as I said, it's opened up lots of questions. It really opened up for me and Jamie a lot of discussions about how awful this use of global average temperature is as a goal for public policy. It's just so, it's non-resonant, it's non-meaningful, and it obscures more than it gives. And so actually one of the things, I mean, interesting follow-ups is we used it because it's a shorthand which people understand. But one of the things I want to follow up is how do we make meaningful goals, which actually would give us something to aim at, which would actually be related to our interests, as opposed to some output of a model, which is not related to our interests. And that's so, there's a long way to go. This is, as I say, this is a start of a 10, but those are, different people, yes, and also they would lead to different ways of framing that. In the end, though, you still have to aim to reduce the risk, adapt to something, contingency plan. Those things, the categories stay the same. But the politics between people with different takes, that's the politics I'd like to see as well. If you come up with a solid basis, then have an argument about who does what and where it goes. That is the real politics of climate change. That's not easy, but it's at least arguing about real things as opposed to arguing about perceptions and ideology.
Just trying to decide if it would be more interesting or duller for journalists if we did it that way. But, anyway,
I think I know the answer.
we're horribly behind schedule. I blame myself, but we obviously want to get everybody here involved in the discussion. So we are going to take questions rather than have big queues forming at the microphones. You will have to ask your question at the microphone. But if you could stay in your seats and just put your hands up, so we'll invite you. And when you do ask questions, if you wouldn't mind identifying yourself and your affiliation and endeavoring to the best of your ability to actually ask a question and not just pontificate, that would be fantastic. So let's go right ahead. The gentleman here right in front.
Pablo Reyes with the Center for Latin American Strategic Studies based in Bogota, Colombia. A year ago, the real Latin America and South America experienced probably one of the worst droughts in over 50 years. Over the past few months, I've seen the rain cause 800 deaths in Brazil, and in Colombia, close to 2 million people were displaced by the floods. During the floods, obviously, banks, clinics, government offices, legal cases, everything comes to a standstill. And I use this to ask two brief questions. One is, what is the in your framework? What do you suggest? Do you have something for interagency cooperation and coordination, both at the national level? Any suggestions on that? And also, what do you do? Are there any suggestions in the report on how to bring the climate debate closer? And people understand when how to deal with a flood, how to deal with a drought, but it's hard for them to understand, why should we care while all the debate is taking place in Copenhagen or in Cancun? How do you bring that closer so that first responders and people who are actually on the ground can use that risk management and plan accordingly?
Two really good questions, and thank God we have recommendations approached to both of them. One of them, which is particularly that, how do you do better analysis of, as you say, these combined effects, which you go through as what we call perfect storms and some of the interactions. And we ask people, the scientists then produce impacts of climate change in the silos of different disciplines, which is fine, that's the way they do it, but actually it doesn't help people understand how they interact with social and economic systems to produce, as you say, you know, landslides, droughts, the impacts of those that ripple through society and ripple through economic systems. And that's one of the recommendations of really investing. And it's not, you can't get scientists to do this. You have to put money into new places and new skills and disciplines to bring skills together to actually do that work, which is actually, I think, what the Navy's doing something of in terms of informing its decision process, as far as I understand it. When I think actually the first example of that, a decision-maker-driven scientific approach as opposed to a science-driven approach, which is a real shift in the debate towards providing information to the first responders, to the people in charge. That's one piece. The other one is precisely this issue of getting the people who run the infrastructure and the contingency planning nationally and the critical and the security area into this debate about mitigation and kind of what's going on in the world. Because at the moment, they are distanced from it. They deal with the consequence, but they have no locus in the conversation. And that's why this national risk management approach, we suggest that's actually the place to do it. And again, in a very real way, I'm currently talking as my role in the UK on the National Infrastructure Committee about how do we characterize climate change risk for making the next $300 billion worth of infrastructure investment in the UK over the next 5 years. We have to give advice to all the people doing the planning on that about what they should plan for. At the moment, we're giving them a probability distribution by a bunch of scientists that is of zero use to someone who's planning a new road or a flood defense or the electricity system. But they want to know, am I building an asset or a liability? Because if you build it the wrong way, this becomes a liability. So that's precisely, there's a whole process we can do there to make, give them useful information, which we're not doing at the moment.
And it's not that the probability distribution isn't relevant to the solutions. It's just that there are about three or four fields in between that probability of expertise between that distribution and the decision maker on building the road or the dam or whatever. Just about a year ago, my colleague from Center for New American Security, Will Rogers, and I put out a report called Lost in Translation that is totally about this concept that there is this space where it's nobody's job between climate science and science writ large. We can include climate economics and all that too, and decision makers and who actually have to make decisions about either mitigating or mainly about adapting to climate change, I would say, because there's so many more people involved in that function. And in that report, we actually talk in the context of the U.S. government. We make recommendations of ways to sort of put some policies and incentives in place to help bridge that gap that both provide a strong demand signal for the information from that analytical community, but also the mandates within the government to have strong interagency processes and to send those demand signals.
So, Courtney, you just played a compliment there. Is it merited? I mean, how do you manage to cross those three or four fields and get information from the scientists to the, you know, naval engineers? And
well, I think that we're in a unique position in that the upper echelons of Navy leadership recognize the challenges that are being faced, and we also have the expertise both within the Navy and Department of Defense, but the federal government as a whole, to reach out to the scientific organizations and dictate what we need to them. And that's a relationship that I think is a little bit unique, but is maybe a model for others. You know, we're able to inform and say to them, this is the kind of information that we need to make decisions. We don't need 100-year predictions necessarily for everything that we're doing right now. We need it on these shorter time scales that we can actually go in to Colombia and other countries and utilize the information that we have right now.
All right, so maybe I'll take another question. The gentleman here at the...
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. My name is Sun Guofen from the Chinese Embassy in DC. I would like to ask Nick a question. Before I ask the question, maybe I'll answer his question, because he raised a question in his presentation: what threat will China pose in 2050? I will assure you that China have never posed a threat to the peoples of other countries. We will never invade, and we will not kill, and we will not enslave the peoples of other countries. And I can assure you, China will never pose a threat to the people of other countries. And I hope that you will be able to get an answer by lobbying the governments of the countries, especially the developed countries, to take a lead in reducing emissions and addressing the threat of climate change. Having said that, I would like to ask the question. Climate change was mainly regarded as an environmental issue. And it seems it's not very effective to address this issue from the long period of time of international negotiation. We haven't moved very quickly on this issue in negotiations or in the actions of the different countries. Would you think that it is easier to sell this issue as an issue of security issue governments or to the different governments, especially to the governments of the United States, to the politicians of the United States? Thank you.
There's two answers to the question as opposed to the statement. One is actually kind of factual, and one's institutional. The first one is, in a sense, climate change moved from being an environmental to a security issue because it's one of the things people don't realize that, when I was at the Kyoto conference, the predictions on climate change were much more mild and much more long-term, and the actual trajectories we're going to have to do were much more gradual than we are looking at now because the science has moved on. I'd love Jay to talk a bit about this, which is the unknown. One of the things people don't realize is it's not that we kind of woke up to climate change, is that the impacts of climate change, the scientific estimates, moved nearer and harder and faster. And the urgency built up over the last 10 years is not because somehow we got it wrong in Kyoto. We did something based on the science at the time, but the science moved. That tells me a lot, actually, the fact the science moved in that direction. But also it means that it is more a security problem now because it's hitting more vital limits. And it's combining with the rise of resource scarcity, which was predicted in the 70s and is a byproduct of poverty reduction in China and other countries, which is a good thing, but we knew that that was going to create us problems with resources and water, with land, other areas, and climate change combines with that to produce security issues. And in my discussions with Chinese security planners, they're very aware of this, and they know that China's extremely vulnerable. And I think balancing China's development and security needs around climate and resources is one of the most difficult things the leadership has to do. And they're very, probably of all countries, one of the few places where the leadership has taken scenario planning and scenario assessments on some of these issues. Certainly the UK government hasn't to the extent the Chinese government has, in my understanding. So it's interesting. But the second reason for moving to a security frame is more that it's actually that frame where the decisions we made. The problem with environment in most governments is it's way out on a limb. And CEPA in China, for example, or most environment ministries are not in the middle of discussions about infrastructure, about economics, about energy systems, energy security, which is actually all the things we're talking about. So as the concept of national security has broadened in the last 10, 15, 20 years, and I think climate change therefore sits naturally in that space because of its broad range of implications and what you need to do to manage it, it doesn't fit comfortably in the environmental silo, and nor can environmental silo move the levers of power needed to address the issues both on adaptation and mitigation. So in many ways, it's been a natural institutional evolution to that space rather than a sales technique, which I think would fail if it was just a kind of sales technique.
What about your experience within government, Dan? Do you find that the very fact that you're thinking about this, or indeed that you're thinking about it from a security point of view, does that sort of turn heads the way just more nebulous tree hugging doesn't?
The DOD is paying attention to this has definitely turned heads, and I understand that. But from DOD's perspective, we view it as a national security issue because we are DOD, and that's the lane that we look in. We frankly believe quite strongly, and this is why I think this this type of approach to engaging kind of a broader whole of government framework for discussing this is actually quite important, is that even if, how should I say this, it's good that we've gotten attention to this, but it's insufficient. And until we get this broader approach, which I think this kind of a framework can help instruct, that's going to be the critical element here. So,
let's take another question. That's right.
Andrew Patterson with EBI. Those were important words from China. I hope we don't let that pass without taking it more seriously. I want to put forward a proposition because I think we're almost there, and that is that you're going to have to engage the bond market and central banks and insurance companies with your analysis. Take that over to DOD to properly engage Ed's question, which is how do we talk to the House Energy and Commerce Committee? That's the audience that has to be convinced in the current political landscape. So to do that, you're going to have to engage the financial community because you're going to have to come to Congress with financing mechanisms solved. We know this. I spent 10 years doing this with Sarah at DOE when we were framing the Energy Policy Act. And so you have to give DOD financing mechanisms, third-party leasing, and a series of other things you have not thought about in order to do things like the DOD Assured Fuels Initiative and other things. Because when we went to DOD and we said, how are you going to buy synthetic fuels? They said, well, we'll just cut a purchase order. It doesn't work that way. You need to build a $4 billion plant to produce the synthetic fuels that DOD needs for its operational missions. You can't do that unless you guys talk to the bond market and insurance companies, which represent the way to bring the future stakeholders to the current dialogue through those financing mechanisms in order to build in the energy security that we need. So I would submit, Ed, everybody will fail unless you engage the financial community back into the debate with the House Energy and Commerce Committee. You can't do it without them.
Okay, so let's try and turn that into a question. Are you not talking enough to them?
What do you think of the proposition?
There you go, Eddie.
Well, I'll just say briefly, I'm not, you know, I am a science geek, but I do work in a very interdisciplinary environment, and what I do know is that while the finance sector and the insurance industry are not where they need to be per se in terms of putting solutions on the table, the insurance industry at the reinsurance level is quite engaged. Some players in the finance and banking industry are within their institutions taking climate change very seriously. I know Bank of America, for example, has a $20 billion investment framework that it's going to apply over the next decade to investing in climate. In all financing, all sectors, building, technology, et cetera, that will work toward clean energy and more efficient buildings and things like this. So there are signs of those sectors being interested. Now, actually getting these broader solutions that you're talking about, I completely agree. I know nothing about that, so I'm going to stop talking now.
And just, I totally agree. Today, and I haven't had the outcome yet, there was a cabinet committee in the UK which was meant to decide, hopefully, the positive fate of the setting up a UK green investment bank, which was going to precisely do that and leverage hundreds of billions of pounds into UK's clean infrastructure and innovation everywhere else, because unlike everywhere else, including in the developed world except for the US, we don't have a development bank that does this. And so we'll see if that, but that's precisely the type of work and where some of the people we're taking this to. And as well as the insurance, we're talking to Swiss Re and some of the big insurance companies. A number to hold. Lots of people talk about China's foreign exchange reserves of $2.5 trillion as if this owning US Treasury bonds is so important. European insurance industry, $22 trillion, much slightly larger holding of international bills and bonds, including dollar bonds. So if we could mobilize that money into this space and it understands the risk, then we really do have a chance of living the problem, delivering the solution, because that's actually more than it takes to solve the climate problem, just according to the IEA.
Yep. Gentleman here.
David Bardeen. I'm retired. I used to be in the federal energy establishment, most recently in President Carter's administration. Dr. Chu mentioned humanitarian response and institutional arrangements. Now, humanitarian response is something most people, overwhelming numbers of people, understand a lot better than some of these other issues we're discussing. Many people relate it to climate issues, right? What I'm curious about is, it's nice to hear that these issues have penetrated the think tank, and I congratulate the think tank and the secretary, et cetera, on that. But how far more does the question of humanitarian response, institutional arrangements penetrate, say, in the Defense Department's relations with Congress, in your planning, your training? You alluded to it, but how much real training, whether it's hours or percentages or dollars? How about multilateral relations between our defense establishment and those of other countries? We see other nations expect their defense establishment to come into crises, and that's true in Eurasia, the Americas, everywhere. And we even had Mexican Marines, as I recall, helping us out during Katrina. So could you, where are we now in penetrating into the consciousness of our defense establishment, in and out between it and its partners and communications buddies, these issues of humanitarian response to big issues that might be related to our climate change problems?
It's a great question, and I appreciate, in fact, the opportunity to talk about some of this, because I think it's some very important work that we're doing in the department right now. And quite frankly, this is building on a lot of previous work, but I think you're going to see some significant areas, including the ones you just mentioned. Here's where we are. So I did say that we are the think tank, and yes, it has certainly permeated our think tank, but it is also permeating the department. In fact, we think this is the best way to ensure that this is not essentially, you know, kind of the issue du jour sort of approach to things, but really is considered as part of our planning requirements, particularly for the long term, but as I mentioned before, in near term issues as well. I'll go back to the QDR for a second, just as a touchstone document to give you some examples. If you look in the QDR, you'll look, I think I mentioned before, we had a section on force sizing and shaping. Remember, again, from a DOD perspective, one of our primary focuses is on making sure we have the right military capabilities down the road, and we tend to look at that in force structure terms, although it is much broader in terms of skill sets and training as well. When we look at that, you'll see two things, I think, in particular that are worth noting and that I think will address some of what you're talking about. One is we are no longer focused simply on kind of the what we would call major combat operations, you know, what in the past has been called kind of a war-centric planning approach for force sizing and shaping. We are looking at a very broad range of activities, from what we call foundational non-conflict type activities, which are exactly these types of activities we're talking about, including humanitarian assistance, disaster relief type operations. I will add to that, I may not have mentioned it earlier, but including things like building partner capabilities so that we can help enhance the ability of our partners and allies around the world to be better prepared for these types of events as well. So all of those sorts of things are now explicitly in the kind of force sizing and shaping construct work that we do. This is intricately now a part of how the department looks forward and plans for the future. I think that's quite significant. I think it's quite important. And I think it will be enduring. So I think that's one area. The other is on the point you also raised with regard to multilateralism. We also explicitly look at this from an alliances and partnership perspective. Our intent here is to work collaboratively as much as possible with allies and partners. And as such, again, we have worked that into our planning construct, so we are thinking of things in that way. You asked about Congress. I will just tell you we have been in active communications with Congress about this approach so that they understand all of these components that are in there, and I anticipate continuing that, particularly as we head into the next round of budget talks. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, my slapdash management approach has led us up to time, but Sarah likes to keep the trains running on time, so we're only going to take one more question. How about right here at the front?
Yes, hi, Carl Husker with ICF Incorporated. Sarah and Jay, I've talked with a lot over the years, so they'll know that I'm putting this forth in a bit of a devil's advocate mode. But first, it strikes me that the risk management framework you're putting forward would shake things up the most on the mitigation front, as opposed to the adaptation front. In a sense, entities like the department, a town, a city, a nation, can choose adaptation steps to take, and they capture most of the benefits, and they're sort of making their judgments about what to do. It seems the tougher nut to crack is the collective global decision on how much mitigation to take. And this is where, you know, I really admire the thinking you're putting forward, but here's my devil's advocate question. Who is really your audience for changing their framework and moving it in your direction? It's certainly not the people on the House committee who first need to accept the science. They're sort of not the audience right now. But I would think that it seems that global leaders have already adopted a risk management framework. They've chosen a target of 2 degrees, but is the problem just that they're not walking the talk? Even the previous administration had a target. It was a greenhouse gas intensity target, and you could argue whether it was the right target. But, you know, are they your audience, or is the people at the recent COPs the target for changing the framework when it seems that they have embraced a 2 degree target? Or is there another stalking horse here, perhaps, which is a framework that's not really articulated much by leaders, but is articulated by sort of the mainstream of the economics profession, which is, like any problem, we sort of put it through the paradigm of benefit-cost analysis, so we should only take steps on climate mitigation that are justified by benefit-cost analysis. Is that sort of the stalking horse here? Who's your audience? Who should change their framework, and in what way? And also, is it decision-makers or the public at large, or both? So that's a lot of balls I've thrown in the air. Catch any of them you want.
A very simple answer. The report is actually primarily written for national decision makers to have a framework for deciding their national interests, which, as an observer of the scene for 20 years, I would say no major country I know, none, including my own of the UK, has done a serious discussion on what are their national interests and what mitigation target they should set, how much adaptation, what do they see as the limits of adaptation in terms of their security based on the global networks and internal positions. So yes, they've signed bits of paper. It's also very clear that the things they've agreed to do not add up to the goal they've set. The reason for that gap is that they're doing what is painless, and what they haven't done is really commit to delivering the goal they've set as a core piece of national interest. So the two pieces is that we want to get that national interest conversation going in India, China, Europe, US, and make sure the right people are in it. And it comes down to it. If the conversation is scientists and environmentalists talking to leaders, which is what we've had for the last 20, 30 years, it will not work, because it's about models and PowerPoint presentations to people who are dealing with real concrete decisions and interest groups. What we need is the people who represent the interest groups of national security, national infrastructure, agriculture, global food security, to have a view on how much certainty they want on the limits of climate change relative to their interests and the things they're responsible for managing in the conversation which defines the national interest. One of which will be around everybody's cabinet table, but it's got a broader span. It's, you know, it's in the Beltway or in the Brussels Beltway if you're in Europe. That's the conversation we want to influence. And we also think there's huge potential for influencing the public conversation as well, though it's not what the report was primarily written to do. It's something that's emerged out of the thinking. And when you get to the House committee, I don't know. But those are the people we want to do it, and that's what the conversation we'd like them to have. Because I don't see how you build a global regime on the basis of people who don't know their national interests, and I would submit none of them seriously know their national interests at this point.
And I would just add, from the risk management perspective, choosing a target does not constitute a risk management framework. It's one thing to say, let's say we did consider our national interest. It is in our national interest to meet a target of 2 degrees. But then you have to ask the question, given that the modeling behind the mitigation scenarios equates to a 50% chance of failing, what do we do in that very high likelihood that it fails? How do we manage the consequences of that? So I would say that, in fact, it highly relevant to adaptation. And in fact, the B in the ABCs is plan and build for 3 to 4, even though you're shooting for 2. So this is, risk management is much more rich than just saying, well, we agreed to a target. Even if you achieve everything you set out to achieve to meet that target, you might fail, the climate sensitivity might be underestimated, and there are unknown unknowns. How are you preparing for those things? That's risk management.
Well, I think this has been a really valuable discussion, and one of the things that I've enjoyed most about it is the conventional wisdom around town for the last several months has been, aside from relitigating the science of climate change, it's not a topic we want to talk about. And I actually think that's completely the opposite of what reality is. And now is the time for refreshed thinking and bringing more people involved in the dialogue about what we do about climate change, given where we stand at a global and a national level. And so we really appreciate the opportunity to have the chance to have this discussion today. And also the point that it's an iterative discussion. I think that the last several years, folks have been operating under this misguided premise that we could make a decision at a global level about what we're going to do about climate change and not revisit it. And that isn't the case. And I think this risk management framework that you put forward helps us because we have to constantly be reevaluating those things. And the perspective that we got from the Defense Department today shows that some people are thinking along those lines. And it would be great if we did it on a more coordinated basis across government. So in addition to thanking our wonderful, wonderful panel for all their terrific contributions, we'd be completely remiss if we didn't thank Catherine Silverthorne from E3G. Hey. And Molly Walton and our team here at CSIS for putting together all this event today, and all of you for being here. So please join me in a round of applause for everybody. Thanks so much.